I'm really relieved you all showed up because there's a lot going on today. So I thought it may just be two or three of us. So this is a great group. I appreciate you coming. I regret we had to reschedule. We had the gas leak the day that we decided that we needed to reschedule. It was just too nuts. And then I know we're spread out all over today. Creek Fest and all sorts of stuff going on. John's at Sci-Fair. How many of you knew that John Fishrow is also serving as VIPAD at Sci-Fair? Y'all know that? So they're without, so he's doing double duty, and I know Carol and your team have really stepped up as well. So that's why John's not here. I mean, everybody's just spread. So I do appreciate you coming, but that's why you see the camera as well, because we knew there were a lot of people who couldn't make it today, so we're recording it for them who want to watch it. So let's say hi to everybody. Hello. Yay. All right, so I've just got some information to share. I hope some of it's new news, updates. Maybe it's not all things you already know. And then mostly want to get through that and then have a chance just to answer questions about anything you may have going on. I want to start with just some names up here. If my clicker's going to go, whoops. It's hard to see. I don't know if everybody's here who are new, but these are our new full-time folks since January. Christy, is that what the list we ran? So if you're here, we just want to say hi and welcome. If you're not, that's okay. You don't know that I'm calling your name, but we'll still tell them hi and you're welcome. I'm glad you're here. Dr. Nicole Brown is our new faculty member in Vet Tech. Excited to have her. Ditton Davies, I don't see Ditton at the pack. Corey Colby is, I don't really consider him new anymore. He's really jumped in and led the Poetry Slam and has done some really great work there. Faculty in Government, Audrey Cobina in our LVN program. Paula Dean in Life Path, not the chef. Paula may be able to cook, but not that Paula Dean. Nathan Fortenberry with math. Kelly McNally, staff assistant, Health Science Building. Catherine Sheeler, coordinator 2 and CE. Jared Coots is probably at Creekside. And Kentry Fontenot is probably the newest hire. She's our new COAT program manager. So I just wanted to make sure we all know that we are hiring, and we've got some great folks who have come on board, and welcome them. In a meeting yesterday, we're already talking about planning for next year. One of the things we're going to bring back in the opening week is the introduction of new employees during the welcome stuff that we do. And so those expect that. So anyway, we're excited about that and are already looking forward to even making a bigger deal out of our new folks that come in. Man, you can't see that at all. And I've spent so much time on this. So I want to provide some general updates on projects, some events, some things like that. And since that is hard to read, I'm going to scoot back a little bit just so I'm not in the way. I can see it better. So the four categories I want to update on this is the Oil and Gas Training Center, the Student Services Building, Safety, Security, Cleaning, kind of that broad category, and then 249. You probably have heard or saw in the news that this summer, around July 4th week, we decided to put a hold on the Oil and Gas Training Center. So we had been through a whole lot of work. We had the oil rig donated. The company, it was just us to take possession of. About the same time, there was some conversations with Baker Hughes as well, who also had their training center at 2920 and 2978. And with the oil industry being down, they weren't using their center as much. So it was decided that with the downturn in the industry and with the availability of that space, just to put ours on hold. Frankly, in a lot of ways, that's a bit of a relief because the deeper we got into that and explored the cost to operate and just the challenges and the liabilities and all of that, it was good to kind of take a pause and sit back from that. So because that center was ours really just by geography only, because the 18 acres is in our Tomball area, the programs that are using that are really out of University Park in North Harris. So it's a good partnership, but we're really not as involved in that. Will we ever be? Will it come back? Can we have our own oil and gas center? If we do, it'll be a couple of years. So when you hear the chancellor, if you're in big meetings or hear talks about centers of excellence, Tomball's not being left out, because that was going to be one of ours that was part of the bond and all of this stuff. It was part of our bond package. But a different decision was just made, and probably the right one for now. We still have a very good relationship with the donor of the rig. And so if we're able to, in a couple of years, come back and say, we're going to do this again, I think that relationship is such that we could still have an opportunity there. So I think that's important for you all to know. Student Services Building is our other bond project. It's actually in phase three. So that means that we, over this next year and a half, 18 months or so, we can kind of breathe. We'll get the Health Science Building. We're real close to finishing that project. And we won't have a phase two project in the system. And phase three will begin. And we're looking at January 2019. So we've got some time to do some programming and planning for all of that. Still on the horizon, but just not immediately. The safety, security, cleaning category is a system initiative. Chancellor put in some money for all of the colleges, not at our expense, to do things like power wash all the buildings. So Health Science Building folks, when you, the limestone that's turning green and ugly under all of the metal, that's a common issue across buildings that have that kind of limestone. So all of that's being power washed, parking lots are being striped. There's a lot of investment in security cameras, and just it's too much to detail to get into all of that right here. But Tomball is high on the list. I think Buddy shared with me that we're third in the list for some of that work. And so I was excited that we'll begin to see some of that happen. And that is not something that we just couldn't afford to do all of that. But because of the standards that our chancellor wants for our buildings, that investment's being made. I think that's a really good thing. Now, 249 construction is the one that probably causes me the most heartburn right now of everything that's on that list. I had a meeting last week with Jimmy Martin and his team, kind of where are we on some construction projects. This one, you probably won't see much happen over the next several weeks, but when we come back in January, you'll probably start seeing a lot of activity. The goal for us is to share information with you and our students as quickly as we can as we get it. If there's going to be road closures or detours or challenges getting to the campus or whatever, we're going to try to communicate those as often and as far in advance as we can. So some kind of strategy on that. A couple of the good things I think that are going to come out of it, because it's going to be a significant change. I mean, just you can just picture it, that all of that green and all of those trees are just, it's not going to be there. Serendipity, one of the outcomes from Days of Service, when the group I was with was at a Magnolia, it's not the senior center, but friend center, I can't remember what it's called. And I met this gentleman who asked me about teaching wood table making and working with lumber. He has a lumber mill. And I said, I have trees. And so he said, what can we partner together? One of the goals we had was to find some way to make tables or benches or some kind of wall or something using the pecan wood from all of those pecan trees. Well, what he offered, and I checked out with our legal office and all to make sure it's okay, is if we would donate the lumber to him, he'll build all of that stuff for us at no cost. And so then we can use the tables or whatever's built to raise scholarship dollars for students. So if we sold the table for $200, then we can put that into a scholarship. Someone's got pecan wood table. I mean, it just seems like a good opportunity for us. So we're having conversations with him just about how much wood. He came out, looked at all the trees, and he was like, wow, that's a lot of trees. And so he may not want all that lumber, but it does give us a way to honor what's going on out there. The other thing I'll mention from the meeting last week is the south entrance, not Zion, but the south entrance. They're in the plans is a marquee video sign. And I often get asked all the time, can we get like what SciFair has, that big tall sign marquee that has the video? None of that is final yet, but that's at least in the plans. We're gonna have to have that higher kind of marquee because that entire strip is elevated from south entrance all the way past the north entrance. So people coming by us, the access road's gonna be down here, Tomball Tollway up here. We've got to have that larger sign so people can just see where to turn. Also in the plan still is for the south entrance to have the Avenue Boulevard kind of feel entrance, kind of windy road back coming out facing the library. So all of that's still underway, but that is probably our most pressing and urgent project right now. People development investment. Wanted to give you some dates in advance and kind of give you a heads up on a couple of things you're going to start hearing more about without getting too far in the weeds right now. A group of us attended a Pathways Institute in Bastrop last week. Kim Carter was there, Mindy Coleman, Quentin, me, and Ann. And the concept of pathways isn't new. It's really the how do we keep students on a pathway towards graduation. And it's bigger than just limiting choice in what they take, but it is creating pathways, lanes, or highways for them to kind of navigate within. And what I learned this time that I hadn't really snapped to, that I hadn't heard in previous ones, is some of the case statement reasons why, or making the case for pathways. So when we looked at our data, I'm just going to ask you, you all know, most of you know, that an associate's degree is 60 credit hours, right? The two-year degree, 60. What is the average credit hours students graduate with from here, Tomball? When they graduate, how many hours do they have on average? 100. Our students are graduating on average with 40 credit hours more than they need. Now, don't misunderstand what I mean by need. I am all for go explore. I don't know if I like psychology. I'm going to take a psychology class and I'm going to go figure that out. So need is, I'm not defining it, but it's not important to explore other options. But when you look at it just strictly as trying to help students with their financial aid, they're losing financial aid because they're taking the advisors are shaking their heads. Allison's shaking her head, yeah. They're going to lose that, so helping them be able to get closer to the 60 hours, especially when they're on financial aid, and it's so difficult to be here anyway. So that was just kind of an aha for me that was very, very compelling. When we at our table in our teamwork at that event said, how do we bring this back? What we want to do between now and February 10th is begin to communicate out some of those key case statement points about why this happens. Jennifer, you don't know this yet, but when I met with Jackie today, when we send out the Connecting the Pack every Monday now, we're going to put just a pathways point to ponder or something that's like, did you know that our students are graduating with 100 credit hours? Did you know that it's taking 5 years to get a two-year degree? Did you know? And just start sharing some of that information consistently so that when we get to February 10th, we're going to replicate for the day the experience we had at our Pathways workshop. And that was specifically chosen as the date, not opening week, not January, so that all of our student services and advisors could attend. Because y'all play such a critical, critical role in understanding that Pathways work. So just mark your calendar for February 10th. I promise we'll make it meaningful and not just another day of talk and no action coming out of that. Now that's not just Tomball. Every college is implementing some kind of way to make sure Lone Star as a system is working towards the pathway stuff. Campus Carry survey, several of you that were there. We're in the Campus Carry Forum. But we are now stealing from Kingwood because they put together a really good survey for all of their employees and their students on Campus Carry. And so we're replicating that, and we're going to send that out soon, SurveyMonkey. It's educational just in reading the questions, because the questions themselves help clarify what the law is and kind of what some of the issues are and what they aren't. But then that'll give us good feedback too. When we go into the next stage of the work, which is identifying places at our campus that meet the requirements to be gun-free. And so that kind of feedback we're gonna need so that we can identify those locations. So that's coming, and I'd really appreciate it if you guys would fill that out. Also, the cultural beliefs workshops. I think a lot of us are familiar with the six cultural beliefs now. You know, no fear, trust, better together, act intentionally. I'm gonna forget the other two. I know we're all familiar with it, right? That was really funny. Yeah, got it. That's why we're going to have a cultural beliefs workshop on Friday, December 9th. I know that's kind of a tough day for some of you. So that day is going to be deans, department chairs, directors, DOMs, managers, kind of that level. Organizational development is going to facilitate that for us. And then when we come back in the spring, we're going to have similar workshops, but we're going to do two divisions at a time, like first year foundations and ABS. And then, I don't even know what y'all call yourselves anymore, it's changed. Health, science, and Creekside, thank you, business, yeah. I'm gonna get a vote of no confidence after this because I don't know any of the cultural beliefs or what the departments are called anymore. So just a heads up on that, and I don't mean to make light of the cultural belief stuff. That really is important. And let me share with you kind of a little bit of an aside. What you'll hear in this cultural belief stuff, if you haven't participated yet, is the underlying philosophy underneath it that's really where the magic is. So in any organization, what do we typically do when we want different results or we want to change something? Well, what we do is policies and processes, and we just focus on those things, but we don't change the experiences or beliefs. And until you do that, you're not gonna have any impact. So that piece of it is where I think we need to spend some time really focused on, not just memorizing what are the six beliefs, but really understanding deeper what those are based upon. Okay, events commencement. Let's talk about commencement because that's been what are we gonna do? We have a space, we have a place, and we have a date and a time. So this is big progress here. We had originally made the decision to go ahead and try to do it in the PAC. For those of you that don't know, the church, Woodlands Church, where we usually had it, said we couldn't do it on the normal day and time. They didn't want back-to-back ceremonies, so we had Montgomery on Friday night, us on Saturday. We could do it on a Friday, but it had to be the Friday before finals, which just felt really weird to do. Congratulations, you worked so hard. Now go take your finals. That just didn't fit with us. And so then after finals was difficult because everybody's gone. So here's the short story. We're going to be at a new location. It is another church. It's Faith Bridge. It's located at Steubner Airline and Spring Cypress, kind of. It's between Spring Cypress and 2920. I know years ago, I was just coming on board, there was concerns about being at a church. But we have looked and looked and looked. And Faith Bridge is, of the places I'm aware of that we looked, is if it didn't have Faith Bridge in the title, you wouldn't really know you were at a church. It is a very, very comfortable place to be for those of you who are uncomfortable by that. They have two buildings, and we're gonna be able to use one of them. The larger one is the one we're gonna be able to use. It seats many fewer than the other location. This will seat about 1,100. But what we're, and Ann and I was working with on this, we believe that if with some seating of how we seat some folks on the stage, and then if we have to limit guests, graduates to 4 to 5, they can't maybe not bring 20 family members, but 4 or 5, that's still a pretty significant guest pool that they can bring. And we know not everybody will bring that many. So, and now it's in her court to work all the details out. But so the good news is same date, same time, just a different location. And we're breathing easier that we're actually going to get to have a graduation ceremony. That was getting a little scary. Title V grant, heard me talk about this before. It's getting started. We've got the funding, waiting on one budget amendment from DOE. The program manager for that has been posted. The big change I guess you're going to see is, and I'm going to point the wrong direction, looking at the cafeteria, I'm looking at it, in the hall to the left, there's kind of that seating area with the booths and the kind of that. We're going to take some of that and turn that into the Title V grant area. Because it is a student services function, it's a grant focused on student services, it'll be very visible, very, very accessible. So you'll start seeing some of that happening pretty soon. One of the things Jackie Thomas and I talked about this morning, as a matter of fact, kind of on the heels of Title V, which for those of you that may not realize, that's because of all the Lone Star Colleges being qualifying as Hispanic serving institutions now. So the Title V grant is really, while it helps all of our students, it's really geared at helping our Hispanic students. And so what we want to start, I don't have a timeline for this, but something we're talking about is creating a diversity council for our college. So we've got the Title V grant, Hispanic serving institutions. Quentin is co-chairing for the entire system, a task force to help us improve our graduation success rates of African American males. And so there's just several diversity issues going on, and we thought we needed a stronger committee group here really committed to that to help guide the college. So we'll be moving in that direction. Also, then, a grants council. As you know, there are several local grants. There's CTAC, the Chancellor's Essay Scholarship. There's several things that have to be managed. And then several folks are always coming and say, well, how do we get a grant to support, I don't know, veterans? Richard hadn't done that, but could we get a grant to support veterans? Or whatever you're passionate about, how do we get funding for that? So we're trying to envision some kind of local grants council that can help coordinate all that. So if you're interested in that, be watching for it. And then the existing faculty and staff research council, we want to kind of refocus that. You know, all the GRIT work really started with the Faculty and Staff Research Council, and then GRIT's become its thing. Maybe using that Faculty and Staff Research Council as a think tank or an incubator and really looking at real research. What is kind of what's next? And what could we might create that becomes its own thing? So you'll start hearing more about that. Okay, I'm going to speed up a little bit. GRIT, we had our inaugural GRIT Summit October 14th, had about 80 people here from as far away as Ohio, mostly from Texas, but we had Texas, Arkansas, Louisiana, and like I said, Ohio, University of Toledo. Somehow, I don't even know how they found out about it, but great success. The highlight was when these five students stood up over lunch and told their GRIT stories. And it'll make you cry. And one of the things that I think I'm taking away from hearing their stories is not every story has to be some tragedy. It's just something where they've demonstrated growth or tried something new and different. And so I just wanted to say kudos to everybody that was involved and helped making that happen. It truly, truly was an amazing event. And got some great feedback for going forward. We'll keep doing that and do it again. If you haven't yet, check out, oops, my clicker went to sleep. LaToya's, especially faculty, I know she's done some training. Barbara, I think you've been to one. A couple of you have been to some of the training that she's done. But she is making available some amazing, Gloria, I know you've been really involved in this too, practical, hands-on tools to use in the classroom. Learnwithlatoya.com. And she continues to add to it, and it's just a great resource for all of us here. So I just wanted to point that out and make sure that you're seeing that. And then also our GRIT webpage, and loading that with stories and grit resources. There's just a lot going on there. Just wanted to remind everybody if you hadn't seen that in a while. Personal plug, check out acornachievement.me. It's .me because I wasn't smart enough to figure out how to make it .com. But this is where I'm posting every blog post, everything that I'm doing nationally with grit, and posting here. And so, personal plug, just wanted you to make you aware. If you want to get a, now why are we doing this? There's a lot of that information in this website. All right. Wake up. Not y'all, the clicker. All right, I want to talk about this for a minute. I don't know, Jay, can you click on that Tomball 2020 ACE guide that's hyperlinked? I don't think I can do it from here. Yeah. And then go to the, so this is the COAT website, and then click on the guide right there. Yes. So we didn't copy this because it's 29 pages, but this is available electronically. And I don't know if you make it just a little bit smaller, just kind of scroll through there. Some of you saw I drafted this a couple of months ago, but what we've done as a college now is pull all of our, and I'll go into detail here in just a second, but anything with related with our ACEs, our annual cycle of effectiveness, with the five college system strategies, with the five college strategies, with key performance indicators, and we've shown how they're all connected and aligned. And then for the next several 5 years through Tomball 2020, this is what we're focused on. This is from the big strategy perspective, what we're doing. So again, this is available just like you saw us navigate through. I encourage you to look at it. At the back of this document are the ACE statements for each president's cabinet member. So you know exactly what the what I'm working on, what Ann's working on, what Quentin's working on, what John's working on, and then we've crosswalked everything we're working on to make sure it's connected with the system's priority. So it's pretty neat work. It makes all of the ACE stuff very transparent and more meaningful. So we're in about year four or so of trying to figure this out, and or maybe even five. So I'm really excited about the work that went into this document, and I just encourage you to spend some time in it. Okay, Jay, thanks. If we can go back to the PowerPoint, I'm going to dive in just a little bit. So you'll notice that I've got up there Strategic Enrollment Management Plan, ACE, and then Key Performance Indicators. So those are kind of the three elements of this overall document. I want to take us back to the five priorities. So you've seen the priorities at system office things in that kind of circle. All this does is take those five priorities and put an icon with it, it's just so that we have a visual reference for what each one is. It's the same priorities, just has a visual reference. And then you can see where we've identified who is assigned responsibility for that strategy. So academic workforce quality is a star. Quentin as VPI is the president's cabinet member responsible for that one. Student success is shared by Quentin, Ann, and Jackie Thomas. John has financial responsibility. Jackie and I have culture. And then Jackie and I have partnerships. Now that doesn't mean that Ann doesn't have to be financially responsible. Ann, I know, I use that example on purpose. But when it comes just to that kind of that ownership and making sure us as a college are meeting those, they've got the primary championship role. They're the champion. Then the cultural beliefs already have the icons. These are the six I was referring to a while ago. We had the consultants on this work came out, and it was very, very interesting. The steering committee group for the system and then Chancellor's Cabinet met separately, and he facilitated workshops for both of us. Two things from that I want to share that I think is really important. Because the two words are so catchy, act intentionally, better together, We get that. But it's really the sentence underneath that defines what act intentionally is. So for this, act intentionally is create goals, make decisions based on meaningful data. But when people are talking about act intentionally, I don't have a real example, but I'll make up one. Sue, you really acted intentionally when you asked when PSSA could put up the Christmas tree. Well, that's acting intentionally, but that's not necessarily making a decision based on data. Y'all see the difference? So that was a takeaway from that workshop, is we need to step back a little bit and focus on what the definitions of the values are a little bit more, rather than just the two words. Now, if you, I don't want to put anybody on the spot, but I will. So if you had to guess, now keep in mind, steering committee, Christy knows where I'm going, steering, because she's on the steering committee, had a workshop and they did a, we did a process, as did Chancellor's Cabinet, of which ones as a system do you think we're doing well and which ones need improvement. So two groups did it totally separately and the results were exactly the same. Which ones do you think were, had the most, we'll do the positive first, had the most blue stickers on doing this really well? Which ones do you think? Anybody better willing? Students better and better together. Those were the, it was obvious, those tons of blue stickers. Anybody willing to guess which two had all the red stickers? Bingo. I mean, that we all intuit, we know that. And so that was really compelling that we all, across these groups are saying we need to focus on those areas. Why is it that way? What do we need to do differently? And so I'm excited that there's that commonality in understanding and now a commonality in knowing what the issues, where we need to work. So more about that later, but I just think that's important that as a system, everybody recognizes that. So what we did then, I showed you the icons for the five college strategies, the icons for cultural beliefs, and now, and again, you can't see it, the font didn't work, five college strategies. So I'm just gonna read it to you, but these are in that handbook I just referenced. So under quality, and then I think that's icon for act intentionally, achieve academic and workforce program quality by developing a framework for growing Lone Star College-Tomball workforce programs. So that's a college strategy over the next, until Tomball 2020. Doesn't mean academic support and doesn't matter and all of that, but there's a very much an intentional decision to focus on growth of workforce programs. Next, achieve student success through Tomball 2020. Remember the Tomball 2020 group where we had the four scholarship award students and offerings. Now Tomball 2020 is emerged in that, but the overall plan is Tomball 2020. So we're using some language kind of moving from Tomball 2020 being one project to this overall plan. Achieve financial wellness through transparent processes, collaborative efforts, create and stay in a compelling, empowering college culture, and build relationships with organizations to collectively impact college and community success. So big picture stuff. And then for each of the ACEs, and this is just an example, so I took the student success one, so the goal is promote student success by ensuring excellence in teaching, learning, student-centered support services. That's the system statement. Our strategy, achieve student success through Tomball 2020. The system objectives are listed here that come out of the goals, goal setting, academic career pathways, curriculum instruction, etc. I looked at each of the ACE statements for Quentin, Ann, and Jackie, and then made sure that we had, oops, my check mark went away. That one's actually checked. That we had at least one action step or one strategy for each of those, okay? So my point, and I don't want to get too in the weeds, but my point for that is to show there is real alignment, real connections, and real, and it's all very, very visible. Let's see. Strategic enrollment then, that was another area. Increase our headcount by 2% each year through Tomball through 2020. It's very quantifiable. Increase contact hours by 3%. Ensure that we're focused on persistence enrollment, increase degree completion by 2%, and improve branding and visibility of Creekside in the Health Science Building. So those are enrollment strategies for the next till Tomball 2020. Getting too deep in the weeds. Let me move. Wake up. All right. Now, if you weren't asleep before, we're going to go to sleep now because we're talking about money. Every time I've had this forum, I think it's the third time now, money, being really, really transparent about the budget is very, very important. The good news is that our allocation this year, as you can see here, is significantly more than it was the year before. So that's really good. Some of that's because of raises and some other things that really help us but don't necessarily increase our operating dollars. But what's significant is that this year, the model wasn't just built on growth. It was also performance. So in this $22 million that we are operating on this year, $84,000 came from performance funding. And that's significant. An additional $64,000 came from contact hour growth. Quentin is also on a committee system-wide that for performance measures that solidifies the way colleges are going to be funded based on performance. And so we're going to see a shift. We are seeing a shift from it only being based on growth, which is good for us. I guess it's kind of a catch. It's kind of, what was, who's the singer that sings, Isn't It Ironic? Who was it? Yes, Alanis. The year we grew was the year the budget model changed to performance instead of growth. But we did get some growth money. So just official day headcount comparison. Our fall and spring kind of have come together. We had 9,013 official day this fall. We had 9,027 last spring. So it's just kind of interesting to see that. But here's what I'm excited about. This is duplicated headcount. So headcount's headcount, enrollments are duplicated headcount. We had a 5% increase in our duplicated or our course enrollments from last fall to this fall. That's huge. That is tremendous. Yeah, thank you, Deb. And that's a lot of the work that the deans, the Quentin, the everybody contributed to this. And to see that kind of significant jump, I think, is really a manifestation of that work. There was a 10% increase between where we were in the spring to fall. So those are trending in a really, really good way, in a way that we haven't seen in a long time. So that's, I want everybody to feel really good about that. Contact hour comparison, our contact hours went over a million contact hours. And we hadn't been over a million contact hours in 2 years. So that's huge. That was another very significant increase. It's the contact hours that we're funded on. So that's an important increase to celebrate. The key performance indicators that we were funded on that I showed a while ago, there's eight of them. All of the colleges are using the same eight for this model. If it's in red, we didn't hit our target, so we didn't receive any funding for those, but we didn't have money taken away. If it was green or yellow, we received money for that. We were funded for those. So there's opportunities to improve, because you see, we had a lot of red. And so a lot of what I'm harping on about this ACE guide and all of those strategies, it's connected to this work here. It's not so that we get more money that's going to benefit our students, but will be financially, the model's going to reward those of us who are able to address these issues. So I think we've just got some opportunities to even do better. Won't get into the weeds on this. This is in the guide. We had to set performance targets for this year, And the instructional council folks worked on that. All of them are very much within reach, and I think we'll be very successful with those. The spring enrollment targets, I really like how Quentin and you guys are looking at the, not just enrollment, but looking at specific categories, online, hybrid, dual credit, Creekside workforce, first time at college, those kind of things. You'll notice that Creekside target is 900 students. So that's would be 159% increase. I think we can do that. So you can see some of this information in the guide as well. Now, I'll skip that one. So even though we have additional funding, if you take last year's presentation, which Carol did for us, and just update the percentages and the graphs, it looks just the same. I mean, there are very, very minor changes. So the same distribution of our budget, 83% in salaries and benefits. That's just about what it was last year, if it wasn't higher, maybe 84 last year, but within that range. That's a whole lot of money tied up in your budget. Doesn't leave much for operating, but don't read anything into that. That's just a fact. And what I'm learning is that's not unusual just to Tomball. That's what most of the colleges except UP, who's still so new, are experiencing as well. Most of it's in instruction, almost 60%. And we still have frozen positions. Of all of our salaries, $15,270,000 are not frozen. So that's a whole lot of that allocation. $809,000 we still have in frozen positions. That figure last year was almost $850,000. So that is indicative that we're unfreezing some things and moving forward on some stuff. We're still underfunded in adjunct faculty. We kind of do that on purpose, so it doesn't alarm me too much. We just manage it throughout the year. But the good news in this one is last year's slide, the underfunding level for adjuncts was 1.3 million. Now it's just a million. I mean, that's, okay, that was kind of funny, but it's kind of scary. It's a little bit scary, but it is less. So it was higher last year. Again, frozen positions is still one of our biggest sources of savings, and any kind of positions that we defer the hiring, that's our other big source of savings. We always track, we look at this twice a month and identify where we can cut, where we can't, and we try to be as conservative as we can, but not so conservative we're not able to function. We know we need to be able to function. So right now we're looking at a shortfall of about $531,000. Last year we did finish the budget. The gap was bigger, and we did finish the budget in the black again, which was just everybody's contributions and willingness to help. But as John put it, if you had $1,000 in your bank account at the beginning of the year, you ended the year with $1.85. So that's how we ended our year. We were in the black, but we only had $1.85 left. So I do appreciate that we're able to say we finished our budget in the black. Our auxiliary budgets are a little bit different this year because of the way food service has changed. And when you look at our initial allocation, it was $500,000, but there's $360,000 of that. It's kind of like, here's your allocation, but I'm going to take it back. Is tied to things like Honors College. It's employee scholarships to go to grad school. It's any of those kind of initiatives that are system-wide, they're paid for out of our auxiliary. So that kind of comes off the top, and then that leaves us $140,000 to work with for the year. So we're trying to manage that very carefully as well. So these are where we pay for things like the Christmas party or sponsorship for the Tomball Holiday Parade or those kind of things is where we pay for that from auxiliary. When we look at what we've committed for the year, we've already committed $125,000 and change. So we've only got about a $14,000 wiggle room in our auxiliary budget this year. So it's not a lot, but it's not zero either. Okay, we're almost done. We still have the lowest commission rate of our bookstore of the other colleges, and our target this year is $310,000. And then let me move into system updates and we'll be done. D2L, for especially for faculty, you may have heard that that contract was being looked at. True, it was only being looked at because legally, because of purchasing requirements, it had to be. A contract has been negotiated to extend it through December 2017. And so that's kind of, everybody can kind of breathe a little bit, but in the spring they're going to have to do an RFP. But that's a legal requirement. So don't be too alarmed if you start hearing about that. Don't be too alarmed either if you start hearing us talk about a move to digital resources away from print. So that's a conversation that's happening system-wide. The chancellor wants us all to look at that. Talking with Cengage, Pearson, and Barnes & Noble, maybe some others. The model is that some, like San Antonio colleges, I think, have done it. Some other colleges have done. I know one in Louisiana has done it, is where they add a flat rate, like $65, to a course that covers the book. And you're not buying a $150 book that's print, but you could print the book if you want it. So if students who want print could still get it. That is a very, very preliminary discussion. It's driven by the cost of textbooks. Students who are showing up without, they just can't afford the textbooks. What are the options? There's pros and cons to all of it. In our College Leadership Council meeting, our Student Government Association president sits on that, and he had some really good points about, he gets all of his books electronically, but he says, if I don't have Wi-Fi, some of them I can't access. So what we want to recommend as we move through this is that we also include the Student Government Association presidents from all of the campuses, maybe, on a committee that's looking at this issue to get the student perspective in it. But we'll need a lot of faculty input. This isn't going to be a decision that happens overnight, and it won't happen without a lot of conversation with the faculty. Dashboards are coming for budget management. Everything I just showed you as far as graphs go, Carol and I just developed, but the system is developing system dashboards where we can just log on and see how much have we spent, where are we short, where are we going. Just heads up on that. And discounts, you're also going to start hearing about some exploration on reducing tuition in non-peak times. So the evenings, weekends, mid-afternoon kind of thing. That's a system-wide conversation, not just a Tomball conversation. But I think that's an important one to have as well. Okay, went to sleep again. The new EVC, Executive Vice Chancellor, if you haven't heard, is Alicia Harvey Smith. She's a president up in Rhode Island. She serves on the American Association of Community Colleges board and has been very involved nationally, and she'll start December 1st. The CFO search is still underway. You may not know this, Carol. I don't know if John knows. Jimmy Martin, who served as Vice Chancellor for Facilities, resigned yesterday. So John Posh is serving as his interim. And then most of you probably know, but I wanted to make sure and mention it, that our HR office overall now reports to Mario Castillo, who is OGC. So I think that move, he's a labor law expert, and I think his experience will really help move some things in HR as well. So I wanted you to know those things from system. And I think that's all. Yeah, one woof, one pack. Any questions? I didn't leave much time, but do want to, that was a lot to cover, but there's a lot going on. Barbara.
I don't know if this is a question or maybe a concern.
Okay. Is that just Tomball or
just
overall?
Just that.
Okay.
Yeah. So as we're talking about our
Right.
I was just wondering.
Sure, good question. I would answer that as it's an and. It's not an either or. I think there's an opportunity for us, especially with the reduced tuition and some things happening like that, that we could really capture some more students in face-to-face and online. I don't necessarily see it as as an or, but no one has said we're only going to focus on online. So I wouldn't say it's a goal from that at the expense of face-to-face. I think we still continue to do what we can to increase the face-to-face as well. But I don't want to say we're not going to focus on online growth either, because that still is an opportunity for us, for our students too. So I don't know if that allays your fears or not, but I would say it's an and approach. Yeah, Sue?
The $360,000 funds that are the initiative funds, mm-hmm. did you say is used for staff tuition reimbursements? Staff at Tomball or whatever the other items that you use for, if it's not used here, does it go to someplace else and we don't get the money back, or what is the...
So it's really, let me repeat the question so that it gets captured and make sure I understand it. So the $360,000 that's taken, or I don't mean it like it's snatched or anything, but that's used for those system initiatives, if we don't use it here, where does it go? Is that the question? It's not really, Carol, you may have to help, it's really not, we never see the money really. So it's, here's Tomball's allocation, here's Cy-Fair, UP, North Harris allocation, and this percentage of that is gonna be pulled together to fund honors. And another percentage is gonna be pulled together to fund, what's another example, the award ceremony, or, we don't really ever touch it. Does that, I don't know if that helps clarify or even gets to what your answer is. I think the lesson for us in that, and I'll use, if David was here, the Model UN example. A lot of questions have come up in the last couple weeks. Oh, system may fund Model UN. Sure, but what that means is Model UN would go into one of those, that'd be the same thing as honors. It would be taken from, funded from the auxiliary allocation. So system funding it means less for us in our auxiliary. Okay, so that's the clarification. So it's kind of fun to think, well, system will pay for that. Yeah, but what that means is they're just pulling the funds to system from what the colleges would manage, which is, I mean, it's not a bad strategy, because we've got to support those initiatives, but I just want us to be careful about thinking system's going to fund something, because ultimately we are, right? Okay. What else? Yeah, Darrell. Not that I'm aware of. The question was, has any of the other colleges done something with FaithBridge before? I don't think so. We tried to go to some of the other locations where the other colleges are, but the schedules were all off. We were back to not being able to be on our date and our time. So far, working with FaithBridge has been very positive, though. So I think we'll have a good experience. And if we don't, we'll try something next time, something different.
Dr. Nutt, I was wondering if it's me.
Oh, there you are.
Hiding over here in the corner. What is our graduation rate here at Tomball?
Oh, goodness. A number I'm going to have to remember. Do you know what it is? I've got the printout over here. Let me ask another question. I'll look it up. Barbara, I've got it over here. You're going to wait for me to look it up. So, let's see if I can read. Did I pull it out? Did I pull out the KPI? Degrees So I'm maybe answering it a little bit different. The degrees and certificates awarded in last year was 691. So we've got 9,000 students. Not all of those are ready to graduate. Our target then going forward is 779. So overall, that's still a pretty low number. But it's going to matter how you calculate it, because if you just do a percentage of your total population that at work, because some of them are in their first semester. So that's the detail that I'm not able to answer. But Ann, if you'd help us get that, it'd be good. Right. And it gets complicated too with the KPIs, because a lot of that is based on first time in college students, and that's a fairly small percentage of our overall. So it's a percentage of a percentage that, so it gets a, it really gets a little complicated in the definition of the numbers. But okay. I do know that Lone Star as a system, though, is one of the top degree producers in the country. We're rated like second or third. Part of that's volume, but by percentage, we're still high. So that's, I think, indicative of the challenges all colleges are having. It's not just unique to us that so many students just aren't finishing what they start. Yes?
With the construction that's going to be happening,
she's got the language down, doesn't she? You got it right. Yeah. You know, that's a really good idea. We should look at the hold harmless when the construction starts, except I don't think hold harmless exists anymore. I'm going to answer your question then, but something I wanted to say in the budget that's a significant thing that you just reminded me of. One of the things that's different with the allocation this year, too, I mentioned that it's based on performance and growth, not just growth. One of the big challenges we had last year was that we had to give 2% of our budget back. We couldn't spend 100% of our allocation. That was how system was using it to build some reserves. We also had to give money back mid-year when we didn't hit our enrollment target. And so those two whammies, we sent back $640,000 on those two items, not being able to spend 100% and the mid-year adjustment. So the $22 million that we have allocated now, we will not have to give an adjustment. There will be no mid-year adjustment, positive or negative, and we can spend 100% of that allocation. So those were two big positives for us. Okay, so you reminded me to say that. Yeah, I think we all need to be concerned about access to the college during that construction time. Now, one of the goals and what John and I communicated when we met with Jimmy Martin and his team was to ensure accessibility is always good by finishing that south entrance sooner than we're fully impacted by the construction so that they can get in. And we've been assured that the timeline will work on that. So hopefully, by managing what we can do to stay accessible, the impact will be minimized. But I think it's definitely something we need to be worried about. In fact, when we talked about doing the graduation at the PAC van, I guess in Faculty Center somewhere it came back with feedback that said, wait a minute, that's all going to be under construction. That might be not such a great option because of accessibility. So we're trying to think ahead of those things, but I am worried about that a little bit. Anybody else? Deb?
With the thought of accessibility in mind, is there going to be any expansion for online classes? Is that being looked at as well?
Yeah, and I think there, and that kind of goes to Barb's question earlier too about, is it just online or is it online and face-to-face? Capturing online is a way to kind of to mitigate some of the effect from the accessibility just physically to the campus as well. So we have, I can't remember what the number is. You know, we do have, and it's in here, I could look it up, targets for online and hybrid. And we did see significant growth in those areas this year. And as you've pointed out, we kind of hit 50-50. We're more, maybe tipping more towards online than face-to-face. So I do think the online will help mitigate that a little bit. Yeah, there's the.
So I don't surprise you again. I think we lose a lot of our students to University Park because they have access to public transportation. Mm-hmm. Do you know if the city of Tomball has any plans to?
That's an interesting question. I have not heard about any public transportation conversations in any of the groups that I'm in. There's a neat group in Tomball that meets quarterly. That's Bruce Hill, guys from the chamber, Tom Jackson from the hospital, the mayor, the city manager, me, the emergency response head, and it's a no minutes meeting. So you can just talk about whatever's going on, it's just to be able to share information informally. That's the place where I would hear that coming up, and I haven't heard that conversation. Now, what might be interesting, and maybe a benefit, now that the tollway is coming through, and there is that, man, we're going to have so much increased traffic now, the timing might be more right for the expansion of public transportation like that up here. So maybe that's a good question. Maybe that's something we can look at once that road is there. I think that opens that possibility up. I agree with you. I think where my brain goes is even with our Life Path program, public transportation for that population of students is really critical, and we just don't have that here. And in working with those families and in that group to get that program started, that question gets asked every time, is would transportation be available?
International students, too.
Yeah, international students, good point. And just lack of ability to get here. So we'll put that on we'll kind of watch that. Be good. Yes, sir.
I promise
you
didn't
ask this. Oh, no, I hate it when someone starts a question like that. Okay.
No, just because I'm sitting next to Jackie. Oh. What are the specific things that you're looking for to achieve with the Title V grant?
You hand it to microphone to Jackie Thomas.
A lot, actually. I mean, I think the core fundamentals of the grant is for us to increase the success rate of our Hispanic students at Lone Star College Tomball. So we've gone in and from when we started working on it a couple of years ago to now, really had a few iterations of what the grant's going to look like. Now what we've done has been very intentional in placing. When we first launched, let me back up. So the grant that we applied for a year ago, we created our own unit, the Center for Leadership, Academics, and Student Success, where everybody was housed in one space. And after thinking about how we could really sustain the grant, we actually decided to take those positions and embed them in their respective areas. So to answer your question, number one, it increased the success rate of our Hispanic students. Number two is to really embed those positions into their respective areas so that once we phase the grant out, we've got positions in place to really continue to support that population. We can also connect it to the work that we're going to do. I think you may have mentioned the diversity initiatives. Mm-hmm. So that will be crucial as well. So being able to develop what our actual statement is around diversity here at the college, looking at how we can support other populations. I think all of that is going to tie into the work of our office of strategic initiatives, but I mean, right. From online stuff, I mean, each of the positions that we've hired, there's an advisor assigned, there is a professional development position that is specifically looking at how we support the college. So we talked about educating, we can't expect people to serve specific groups without understanding how to serve the group, right? So I think about Hispanic students, there's cultural things that faculty and staff may not be aware of, so that professional development piece is going to be crucial. The advising is going to be helpful. We have a parent navigator position, so there's a parent who's going to go out and build relationships with members of the community. There's an outreach position, so I think it was very intentionally designed for us to go out and do some great work to support that population. The beautiful thing about the grant, too, is that it supports everybody. So although it's targeted at Hispanic students, every student at Lone Star College Tomball can benefit from that work. Did you talk about the space?
Just very briefly. I didn't. I just described where.
So we're eventually we'll renovate a piece of the cafeteria area to turn it into the actual Center for Leadership, Academics, and Student Success, and then build a grit lab in there. So, I mean, there's going to be some really awesome features that we'll see in the next couple of years. So I think that's the goal, to grow it, to make something that's sustainable, and ultimately to help our students be successful and our faculty and staff to better support the students that we serve here at the college.
I think the sustainability piece is important because this is a personnel-heavy grant. You've heard several advisor, parent navigator, professional, you've heard several positions referenced. One of the requirements that we built into the grant, and North Harris got this grant as well. We're not sharing the grant. We each got our own grant, but we each have the same requirement, and that is to raise money to sustain the grant after 5 years. Our obligation is to raise over $450,000 over the next 5 years to sustain this grant. So we can do it. We're sweating a little bit. Jackie and I have a meeting tomorrow with our foundation, though, to begin that process of how do we do it, what are the strategies, what are the requirements, and we'll have help from our foundation. And I've already had Hispanic leaders within Lone Star, specifically on our board, and within the community say, we're going to support this. So I really think we'll be able to accomplish that. But from day one, that's got to be a key focus, because what we don't want to happen is that was a great 5 years and then have a fantastic program and then nothing to sustain it. So it really, while we say it's a 5-year grant, this is a long-term thing. This is something that we'll have for a long time. Okay. Richard?
Students coming in the next few years, are there any thoughts about the system or college being able to provide students inexpensive laptop, Chromebook, whatever, or they just, you know, they're paying some kind of warranty?
Yeah.
Because I'm listening to my grandkids talk about this stuff, and they take nothing home. Everything's on a laptop.
Same here.
At school, and I mean, you know that firsthand. And it's not scary to me. It's interesting, but it's a matter of, so when they come to us, we're back to, do you have something in class to use, or you know, right, as we change our style? And so many of my students don't have that, surprisingly.
Yeah. That question, I think, is imperative to bring up as we talk about digital resources. Mm-hmm. So if we shift to digital resources, the assumption is you've got something digital to use. And if they don't, then what have we done? So I think that's that. In that question in our Faculty Senate President's meeting with the Chancellor specifically was asked. So I think that's where that conversation is going to, you'll see that starting is within that conversation about going digital. But it's a great, great question. And I think we have to look at that. And that, to me, falls sort of under that whole discounted tuition, digital resources, reducing the cost. How do we provide a resource for that? So keep that thought, and we'll keep that in front of us. Okay. All right. Thank you all. It's good to see you, and appreciate you coming out.